Okay, so according to the nuclear clock by which the iPhone is set, it is now 12:30. So is there anything that's missing people? You're missing people. Which groups are totally here? Two groups are totally here, and three groups are missing people. Okay, well, I could be draconian, I suppose, and say you're going to go without your group members. But what we'll do is the two groups that are here, I strongly suggest that you tell your group members that are not here that they need to go. So the two groups that are here, they have everybody else.
That's my group member.
That's your group member? We'll do those. We're going to do two groups today, and then we'll do three groups on Tuesday, and then we'll talk about employee responsibilities a week from today. So, the two groups that have all their members here, we'll let them go first. You want to go first, probably. You have the PowerPoint. Are you sure?
I thought you were going on Tuesday. Yeah, I wrote it on Tuesday.
No, it's today and Tuesday and then Thursday as we would start talking about employee responsibilities. So, are you guys ready to go?
Yeah.
Are you guys not ready to go? Are you guys ready to go since you're a group? Okay, we'll go with these two groups and then the other three on Tuesday. So, if you want to load, and why is this not? There we go. You guys are going?
Yes, so.
Where did you want?
Oh, might as well.
Okay.
No, I went to the art.
Okay, so we did ours over the Volkswagen scandal, and so basically to sum it up, some of their employees used what's called like a defeat device, and so it could detect like when the car was being tested so that it would show like less fuel being emitted into the air, and the EPA found that 482,000 cars were affected by this. And also, they were releasing like 40 times the amount that's allowed to be released. So, it's a big deal, and tons of cars were affected, and people who have these cars, had to deal with it, and it's just caused a lot of commotion.
All right, so we went over the theory of psychological egoism, which it's the theory that humans are motivated by their own self-interest. And then I found an article by Elliot Sober of the University of Wisconsin. And there was a quote in there, he said, like, egoists may take an interest in attaining objective wealth and power. So that kind of described, like, the whole scandal. And then there's another thing about Volkswagen. They said their goal in 2007 was to overtake Toyota and become the biggest car maker in the world. And by doing that, they did the whole defeat device, and that caused the whole scandal.
So with their image, there was a lot of backlash from Volkswagen in the United States before this even happened. There was already a bunch of tension because Volkswagen is centered in Germany. Their voice wasn't really being heard here in the United States. And so with this happening, it just kind of added to what was already going on. So they appointed a new CEO, and then he basically said, I'm going to build a better relationship with them since we've screwed up so bad. you know, we need to fix this. And so he started reimbursing all the dealerships for every single car that was on the lot that had that defeat device in it. And then he started actually paying them for each Volkswagen car that they had on there. He'd pay them a fee every month for any Volkswagen cars that were sitting on their lots. So he made a $600 million investment into the American manufacturing plant. He basically, another one of the issues that the United States had was none of the Volkswagen cars were really centered to the American lifestyle. And so Volkswagen decided it's supposed to come out sometime this year. They've created a car that's meant for the American lifestyle. It's kind of like a Ford Escape, like a SUV type car that they've made. And so they've made it specifically for this market, and then they're producing it in the Tennessee plant is really what they're doing to try and show that they care about the American, like the U.S. market and everything, that they're not just centered in Germany, they're centered here as well.
So taking the situation and applying psychological egoism into it, Volkswagen was in simply just acting on self-interest. They wanted to, like what Jordana said, they wanted to be the biggest auto manufacturer. And so to get that biggest larger market share, they wanted to use defeat devices. They wanted to take the easy route, take some shortcuts to be able to achieve that goal. And so they ignore the moral ethics by only focusing on being in competition, doing what they can to be able to do better on tests and be able to get a vehicle out that they can market and try to, in a sense, just try to beat the competition. But with the goal of being the biggest auto manufacturer and prioritizing like profit as well as market share over the customers, which should have been their number one priority, they lost sight of what's important. And so because of that, applying back the psychological egoism, they pretty much shot themselves in the foot by doing this. And this had a negative effect on their brand image as well as their relationships with their customers as well.
That's all
we have. Is there any questions or anything?
No questions?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I have questions. All right. What a surprise. I have questions. Okay, so you analyzed this using a psychological egoism, and one of the things that Hobson said in promoting a version of this called ethical egoism is that, well, what seems to be in our own self-interest may actually not be in our own self-interest. And so what we need to do is we need to channel people into behaving in a way that benefits the overall greater good while promoting their own self-interest. So one of the things that I find interesting about this scandal is that if the history of information in a postmodern age means anything, it is at all predictive, it's that when you try to cover things like this up, they just don't get covered up. It's almost impossible. I mean, if you start with Richard Nixon, like if we analogize this to the political world, Richard Nixon, you know, has these people in his White House that are called plumbers. They're supposed to fix leaks, and they break into the DNC headquarters, and it's not clear whether or not Nixon knew about it beforehand, but he certainly knew about it afterwards and tried to cover it up. And it didn't work. I mean, the cover-up completely failed. The reason Bill Clinton got impeached was because he tried to cover up. If he had just said, yeah, I had sex with that woman, and that would have been the end of it, and we never would have had an impeachment. I mean, once you get more than two people involved in anything, the ability to keep it secret diminishes exponentially with each additional person that you add. And in doing something like this, you're not talking about one person or two people or the CEO. You're talking about engineers and designers. And eventually, and with consumer reporting agencies, like Consumer Reports out there that do this, I mean, that's how they got caught, right? Was somebody wants to do an independent test. How could they have not thought they were going to get caught and ultimately damage their own personal well-being? How could they have not thought they were going to get caught?
I don't think they had a lot of foresight, or they didn't think that far into the future about it. They just were focused on just being like the biggest manufacturer and wanted to just do better than the competition by any means necessary. And so they didn't think about the repercussions or if someone were to find out.
Yeah, but I mean, if you think about this in terms of the ability And one of the things that we used to say, and I've said this before in this class, one of the things that we used to say in marketing was that if one person likes your product or service, this was years ago, we would say they may tell three people. Now they have the ability to tell the world. Information is so available and so quickly analyzed and so quickly easily transmitted that how could they have not, I mean, these seem to be intelligent people, how could they have not thought that they were going to get caught at this? It absolutely floors me. And I think the answer is that they obviously didn't. And it really damaged the overall brand. How do they fix the problem?
I think they're fixing it now with like the new CEO, like saying he's focusing on America, since I guess we were the ones who had the biggest problem.
Yeah, they have a recall put out for all of them, and then that whole paying the fees to all the dealerships, they're actually going to do that until they come up with a way to fix it in every car. So they're going to continue doing it until they can fix what they did.
Who ultimately bore the cost of this scandal?
I think like it's 8 people right now who they're putting the blame on, and they're not like releasing their names or anything, but they're saying that those 8 people are the ones who allowed it to happen. So
ultimately their shareholders.
Yeah.
Face consequences in terms of stock price, right? Loss of profitability. I mean, you're now having to pay out a huge amount of money to fix this. Should there be jail time for people like that? I mean, you just, if I had money invested in Volkswagen, I would view this as you basically stole money from me in doing this. Should they have to face jail time?
Well, if I read it right, I kind of think those 8 people might be, like, that they're being held to that, so.
Different fraud charges.
Yeah.
Should companies, we can now, I mean, one of the things that we do with corporations is we actually charge corporations with crimes. And how do corporations, what do when a corporation commits a crime, when they are engaged in something? Because, you know, corporations are people. What do? We obviously can't put the corporation in prison, can't go down and lock up the building, put handcuffs on it. Who ultimately pays the price of that if we find them, if we find the corporation? The shareholders and customers do, because corporations just pass the cost on, right, to their customers. So ultimately, we end up paying them the price. So should there be jail time for people like this? Should we start sending executives to jail more frequently?
Well, the people who knew about it, like, specifically, I think they should.
I think the fine should be passed on to them.
Yeah.
Directly.
Okay. So were they really, ultimately, given the fact that I said that, you know, all of this comes out, were they really acting in their own self-interest? I don't think they were. I think they acted, in an interest that was totally antithetical to what their own self-interest would be. How long do you think the brand effect will last on their image?
For some, it could last for a long time. For others, if they execute correctly, they might be able to turn some customers around and be able to rebrand their image and hopefully get those customers back that they lost or that they may have lost connections or relationships with.
If you're one of the people, if you're a customer who bought one of the Volkswagen diesels, would you buy another one ever again?
Almost likely not.
Ever?
I wouldn't trust anything new, innovative that they tried.
Yeah, because that was a new thing they were trying. So it's...
I mean, that's going to be the next innovative thing that they try. There's going to be so many different people testing it, figuring out if they're lying again.
The interesting thing in the services marketing literature, Mary Jo Bittner suggests, and research suggests, that if you have a services failure but you recover quickly from it, customers are actually happier than they were if there was no failure. So the question becomes, should you actually plant little failures in? So for example, with Southwest, if they overbook a flight, they will offer huge incentives for people to, you know, we'll give you a free flight anywhere in the United States for 2 if you'll give up your seat to somebody who really needs it. And people are actually happier at the end of the day when they're asked customer satisfaction surveys on things like that than they were before the service failure happened. Why is that not the same here? They're going to fix the problem, ultimately. Why do you think that the same won't be said? You just said you probably, if you bought one of the cars, would not ever buy another Volkswagen again from them. At least three of your members said that. You said you wouldn't trust their innovation. Why do you think it's different in services?
Well, in the car industry, I think it's because it's not something that you do that often. You don't go buy a car very often. So if something like that happens to you, you're definitely going to be skeptical. It's a large purchase that you're making, and you're putting a lot of faith into that purchase that you're making.
The similar thing happened with the miles per gallon estimates, the highway estimates on hybridized cars when they first came out. They estimated them much higher than they actually produced, but that was just a fault of their statistics, and people were still highly agitated by that. And yet in the services industry, they're sort of willing. Why do you think that is, that they're willing to overlook it in services and not
with products too? It's kind of like you're stuck with it.
Yeah, I think
like,
that's it.
If you have a car, I mean, you either have to sell it or
yeah,
like with the Southwest thing, like they'll get home the next
day eventually, or the next flight. Southwest usually they guarantee that you'll get there the next within the day if they ask you to bump. So they will get you home somehow. And so I think that's it. It's not a major life purchase like a car or something like that. Okay, very good. All right, second group. If you download it, click the download button.
Yeah. There it is. Okay. So we're talking about specifically the allocation of scarce resources based on individual community needs. And so what that will mean is that a scarce resource is a resource that has unequal balance, where there's an unlimited demand and a limited supply for a scarce resource. And so looking at it through a communitarian perspective means that there's a non-egalitarian distribution of your needs per community. So each community is going to have different needs, and those access to those needs are going to be based on a willingness to pay. And so, like, say gasoline, which is what will be addressed next, you have a different price at the pump even in the same zip code. So we've kind of looked at why certain natural resources, we each picked a natural resource, and why each of those are priced differently, and how certain natural resources, capital, land, and labor, affect the pricing constructs and supply constructs of natural resource distribution. And so that when we create a market, we create a barrier to those resources, because if they were freely available, then they would be instantaneously consumed. And so by creating a barrier to access, it is the most ethical way to distribute resources without unmitigated consumption. So we looked at with two different ethical models. First, duty ethics, Sir David Ross's duplicity of your outcomes. So each community is going to have different outcomes, and then utilitarianism to provide for utility maximization for each individual community. So first, really, we'll have land for oil and gas and coffee and fur, and what's it called? No, that's it. Oh, there's one more.
Gemstones.
So it is necessary to provide access to markets, let's say a gas station, in order to distribute certain end products to consumers. But then why is it that there are certain different prices
kind of begs the question that there's certain price fixing and that there's certain unethical distribution systems for certain natural resources. And so if you look at it for the duty ethics, they're not necessarily universally providing the same cost, but you are universally providing the same access, whether or not you have the ability to pay.
I actually did the scarce resource of the fur. Actually, we all know that fur is a sign of wealth and status, and the types of fur that people wear or have, it really shows where they lie status-wise compared to other people. Fur doubled in the years from 2008 to 2013, from $2 billion to a profit of $4 billion. This provides jobs for 32,000 employees, and around holiday sales, the amount of people who get an income from just furs alone is really incredible. A lot of people rely on this for their jobs, and so furs really hold a sign of higher employment rates and higher profits, and brings more income, not just the United States alone, but globally as well.
Okay, and I talked about gemstones. There's a lot of conflict gemstones out there that people should avoid buying. The article I read talked about looking for companies that buy from ethically sustainable mines. There's a mine in Africa where they pay above minimum wage for their miners and the people that refine them, and they built a whole community for their workers, even the school for their children. Centered utilitarianism, like that kind of gemstone mining, provides the greatest good for the most amount of people.
And I covered coffee beans.
Move over. There you go. Okay.
Yeah. So I covered coffee beans. So if you were online at any point during late 2012, you might have heard that Arabica beans, which make up 70% of the world's use of coffee beans, they should be extinct by 2080 because of global warming, and they rely on a very specific temperate climate to grow. So my theory, utilitarian-wise, was should companies, for the greater good of their customers and consumers and farmers, should they tell customers that specifically? And maybe move from using Arabica beans to Robusta beans, or there's 120 different strands. Maybe we should be using a different type of bean rather than just Arabica, because if it's going to go bad, then maybe we should look at trying something else. And there is some different alternatives, like London used a different kind of bean, but no one liked it because it tasted like dishwasher soap. So maybe if we weren't as picky, we could save this scarce resource and go a different route. I had a really good line in my paper, which I was really proud of, probably the best line that I've written in my whole college career, so I'm going to share it with you, just to kind of finalize it. So it is, similar to how some states monitor your vehicle's emission output, should the coffee collar snugly grasping your only hope for a survivable day tell you how many cups you have left until your only hope for living runs dry? This is where we laugh, because it's a great line. And now I'll pass it on.
Between the coffee and fur specifically, we really use utilitarianism because we were thinking that why market these limited resources that are going to be unavailable quite soon instead of marketing the ones that we know that can sustain.
It's important to not treat these people as means just merely for profit margins, that you're controlling the scarce resources and therefore you should market to them in a way that is ethical and fair, and not necessarily egalitarian, but provides for their ends as well.
Any questions? Okay, well, I have a question.
Yeah.
So, first of all, I'll just ask sort of a, how did you choose the resources that you were going to look at? I mean, there seems to be a real disparate, a very disparate set of resources that you looked at. On one hand, you looked at oil and natural gas, which, at least at the current time, are necessary resources. Even if you look at going electric, for example, buying a Tesla, and Tesla's come out with its first car, it's $30,000. that they're releasing to the market. Even if you looked at that, the way you're going to ultimately fuel that vehicle is probably going to rely upon natural gas or some kind of mineral resource, because the vast majority of electric plants in this country are still coal or natural gas. They're not wind, solar, or hydroelectric at this point. And so you're still relying on natural gas production. So it seems to me that you have this disparate connection between those resources, which are actually critical to a society, and then two that might be even viewed as hedonistic, fur and gems and coffee beans. So how did you choose the resources that you're going to look at?
I think we all had a connection to the things that we chose individually and then pulled them together as one, trying to find a common thread between, is it really ethical to view all of these different scarce resources and all of these different atmospheres and different circumstances, is it ethical or not? And I think we all had a personal attachment to each of the ones that we chose for different reasons, but just tried to bring it together to see it through one point of view.
I also think these were lenses through which you could analyze the use of labor and land as a mechanism for distributing certain scarce resources. And so I think that was the approach was pick a lens and then look at how this gemstone or coffee or whatever exploits or not a certain natural resource like labor or land.
Okay. With regard to coffee, is coffee the only sort of agricultural product that faces extinction at this point?
Not necessarily. You could say tea, although it's major in China.
Bananas. They predict that the banana as we know it, the banana that we grow currently has been severely hybridized and is highly susceptible to disease. And they predict that maybe in the next 10 to 15 years we won't have bananas. So should we start thinking about, how many of you like, that's great for me, I don't like bananas. So that just opens up lots of fields that we can plant, something that's much better in my estimation. But bananas are one. What is your definition then of sustainability?
That through the use of human capital and land, that there is a recurring use of the product or the land that is not detrimental to a certain number of future generations.
The interesting thing is, in the sustainability literature, there's no one definition. Nobody can agree on a definition of what's sustainable. Obviously, there's, the oil industry is sustainable, to some extent. It's becoming more sustainable as they figure out more and more ways that we can get every last drop of it out of even very hard to extract locations. But it's a very difficult area to analyze. And one of the things that's difficult in this, from a utilitarian perspective, is that if we can't even agree on a definition, a common definition of sustainability, how can we possibly perform a calculus as to what creates the overall greatest happiness?
Which I think is why, for that, I didn't use utilitarianism. I used Sir David Ross's
duty
ethics, the prima facie duality, so that way each community receives a multiplicity in their outcomes, and that multiplicity is expressed in gas price units. So if they lower the price enough, you'll consume more. Ideally, if they raise it, you'll consume less. Moreover, when oil is being extracted, like all of these salt cavern storage at Mont Belvieu, Texas, are completely at capacity. And so they have almost unlimited supply of these items. And so you can see the ability to lower the price if you want to get rid of the product.
So should government regulate then? Because obviously this is a commodity that everybody needs. Should governments play a role in regulating that supply and the amount charged for that resource?
Well, I think by the nature of the Federal Energy Regulatory Committee and how they regulate the actual stock market of it, like the WTI and all of the way that the stock prices are quoted, and the way they regulate it from the actual quoting side is where they're regulating it now. but in order, like, if you took away the gas company's, you know, ability to charge a certain price, then they may not be able to get rid of supply as quickly as they need to.
So, I don't think anybody would say that you have a right to coffee beans or a right to gemstones. I mean, you talked about ethically sourced gemstones. I don't think anybody's going to talk about regulating. Although, we do. They did try to break up De Beers. And De Beers, by the way, finally was, they had dropped below the threshold requirement to be listed as violating the Sherman Antitrust Acts. And so the De Beers corporate officers, which are largely the Oppenheimer family, can now actually enter the United States for a long time. They couldn't, and they've become a vertically integrated company, by the way. So De Beers now actually sells direct to consumers. Before they didn't, they sold to something called sites. You had to have a license from De Beers to be a site, and they would sell you the gemstones. They've now started opening. So in the gallery in Dallas, the gallery in Houston, you can actually buy diamonds directly from De Beers, which is kind of interesting. But I don't think anybody would argue that those are resources that we should, other than maybe policing for antitrust. But is there a minimum amount that we would say, for example, in the Northeast, with regard to the live heap subsidy that's provided by government so that people can warm their houses, natural gas and oil heating, that we should subsidize or provide or guarantee a minimum number of units to those individuals who are the most vulnerable and actually need them?
That the government provide them that we, subsidy for
should,
access.
Yes, that we should provide those.
We subsidize all sorts of things. Mohair, people, how much access people need for mohair. So, I mean, the government has every right to provide as
but
much subsidy as they want.
Should we? Not,
do,
not,
they, do, these do, people, do these people not? Can they
do
not
we have a moral obligation to?
To provide for our least advantage under Rawls of ignorance? Yes, we have an ability and an obligation to provide for the least advantage.
Okay. All right. But I don't think we'd argue that with fur or diamonds.
Probably.
Or your crappy Starbucks coffee.
See, they charge so much though. It's kind of like fur.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. The other two groups need to be ready on Tuesday, and then on Thursday we will talk about employee duties as ethics and marketing, what you owe to your employer. So. The other three groups, please be ready to present on Tuesday, and that will take us through next week, and then after that we'll move into product pricing and development, and then we'll do promotion and placement after that. All right?